no pain in the way. My heart needs surgery, my soul needs a prayer. So I run to the Father again and again and again. Run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgery, my soul needs a prayer. So I run to the Father.
All I need is you. All I need. Uncle Bubba couldn't do it. Mm-mm. Buddha couldn't do it. Mm-mm. 401k couldn't do it. Mm-mm. My neighbor couldn't do it. Legalism couldn't do it. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. My best friend couldn't do it. Mm-mm. The bishop couldn't do it. Mm-mm. It had to be Jesus. Oh, it had to be Jesus. I don't know about you. I don't know about you. But I never would have made it without Jesus. Is there anybody in here that knows you never would have made it without Jesus? Give Jesus some glory in here. This is a Jesus church. Jesus. 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 Woo! Give God some glory in this place. Hallelujah. 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 Woo! I heard him say, all I need. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you felt you didn't have no other way. And if Jesus didn't show up, it wasn't going to happen. I come to tell you today, when you find yourself in a situation that all you got is Jesus, that's all you need. I said, that's all you need. Is there anybody in here that knows all I need is Jesus? Woo! Hallelujah. My, my, my. My, my, my. Glory to God. Wait a minute. I don't think the Holy Ghost is done. Can we just get some more of that? All I need. Come on. Come on. I don't think he's done yet. Somebody else in here needs something else. I'm going to get mine. So, I'm not leaving without mine. I don't know about you, but I just feel like somebody else in here needs something. They need something. God says, if you ask me, I'll give it to you today. Oh, come on. Come on, worship. If you need something, worship God today. Your neighbor and tell them all we need is Jesus. All we need is Jesus. Tell somebody all we need is Jesus. Come on. I'm telling you, the Bible says if you'll confess Jesus to the world, Jesus will confess God that you my friend. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Give God some glory in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you, worship team. Bless your holy name. Oh, my. It's something about worship. Woo! That just does something to my soul. Just makes me feel like I'm on my way. Worship just makes me feel like I'm on my way. I'm right there. Glory to God. Give this worship team a hand. Glory to God. Yes. My. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo. Glory to God. I'm glad to see you guys. Amen. Amen. I just want you to know that I've been preaching for a long time. And there have been some times that I literally, Zach, I just preached to the seats with nobody there but my wife and me. And I preached to the seats. But I'm sure glad when God sends a few people. Because you know y'all will make a preacher preach, you know. And so I'm just glad because the Bible says when two or three gather in my name, there I'll be in the midst. So I came, and when y'all came, I just knew the Holy Ghost was here. So I'm here, y'all here, and the Holy Ghost is here. We might as well have church. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo, I feel the Holy Ghost already, Robert. Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Woo. Are there any first-time visitors other than me in here today? Please raise your hand. Glory to God. I don't know about you, but every time I get up, I'm brand new. The Bible says that his mercy is new every morning. So when I get up, I just expect to walk in the fullness of today. Yesterday is dead and gone, and today I'm brand new. Brand new in his mercy and in the fullness of God. Amen. Amen. Ooh, we bless you. We bless you guys today. It's your first time. We bless you. Give our first time visitors a hand. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now, I got one quick announcement, and we'll get to work. We want to know if there's anybody in here that can utilize this service that we're going to provide. There's a sign-up sheet in the lobby on the table. What we want to do is we want to provide internet children assistance with child care monitoring, because we realize that in this season that school's not opening back up, that they're going straight to internet, that there are some parents that got to go to work, and that you got kids that are 6 and 8, and you know, and you just don't want to leave them at home. And then you got some kids that you can leave at home, but you know they ain't going to do their work. Come on, somebody. Anybody got them kind of kids? I know if I didn't watch you, you wasn't going to do it. Well, we just want to be a blessing to the congregation, and so we want to know if it's a need, because if enough people sign up, we're going to hire tutors from Emory Riddle to sit in and to assist the children, and we're going to hire women to monitor the children. This will be Monday through Thursday, 8 to 3. Monday through Thursday, 8 to 3. Now, you got to bring your kid, and you got to pick your kid up. You also need to bring, they need to bring their lunch. That's so that we could cut through some of the red tape and be available for you in 2 weeks. So you need to, your kid needs to bring their own lunch. You need to bring them, and you need to pick them up. Now, that's free to anybody from Mount Zion Tabernacle Church. Amen? Amen. But if you know somebody that's not a member of Mount Zion Tabernacle Church, tell them they could come. It's just $50 a week. I just want my congregation to know that at Mount Zion Tabernacle Church, where you sow, where you're committed, I want you to know that we're committed to making sure that we preach the word of God. Amen. Number two, you need to know that we're committed to being a champion for the underdog, a champion for the lost, a champion for the broken, and a champion for single moms and widows. I promise you, at this church, I'll put all we got behind helping God's people, because we don't need to take no ties to heaven with us. We need to use it on us right now. Amen. That's why at Mount Zion Tabernacle Church, we don't charge for nothing. No dinners, no concerts, no tutoring. Because that's what we give for, to take care of us. Amen? Amen. And I just want you to know that at this church, we're going to be about us. Amen? So if you think you can use that service. Now, if you can't, if not enough people sign up, we won't do it. If I have to send tutors to people's houses because there's only a few, I'll do that. I'm going to make sure that we be a blessing to you guys. You got my word on that. So it's a clipboard in the lobby. Please sign it if you think you can use that service, and we'll be in contact with you. Also, if we don't have your email address, please put your email address in our book in the foyer, because we need to contact you. You know, there may be a situation where something changes. I need to be able to get in touch with you guys. I promise you, we won't send you any spam. Amen. We just want to stay connected to you. Glory be to God. Amen. We have been having a wonderful time on Tuesday Talks with Pastor. I don't know if you know about that program that we've established, that every Tuesday at 6:30, we go Facebook Live. I just sit behind my desk and we study precept upon precept, line upon line. Why don't you join us? Amen. As a matter of fact, if you're on Facebook, why don't you like us on Facebook? We also put poignant information upon Facebook. Amen. Glory be to God. I don't know if I missed anything, but I know they're going to tell me. I tell you what, You got a bulletin? Hold your bulletin up if you got a bulletin. Let's just do it like this. Turn to the announcements. Hold your announcements up. Okay, we just read announcements. Amen. Okay. Amen. So now I ain't going to get in trouble. Amen, Kaylee. Let's get to work. Father God, we pray right now in Jesus' precious name, Father, that you would anoint me to bring forth your word. Lord, put your super on my natural. For Lord, I am impotent to do anything without you. God, I'm asking that you would put the Holy Spirit on my inner man. Father, that the meditations of my heart would be pleasing unto you, and that the words of my mouth would be edifying unto your body. Lord, use these lips of clay. Hide me behind the bloodstained garment of Jesus. Lord, let me be small and you be big. Let your word you sent today, your word, Lord, let it go magnified to your people in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Amen. Let's get to work. Let's turn our Bibles, if we can, to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. You doing all right, woman of God? All right. Hallelujah. I appeal to you, brothers. Now watch this. When he said brothers, he wasn't just talking about me and my armor bearer. Okay? When he said brothers, he's talking about women, men. He's talking to the body of Christ. This scripture is talking to us. It says, I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree. And that there be no division among you. But that you be united. United in the same mind and the same judgment. Glory be to God. Look at somebody and tell them, harmony is living united. Harmony is living united. Harmony is living united. Harmony is the quality of forming a pleasing and consistent whole through agreement. Harmony is the quality of forming a pleasing and consistent whole through agreement. Watch this. You can't be in harmony with other people until you in harmony with God. One of the problems that we having today in this society, we trying to connect with one another without Jesus. You can't have harmony with nobody else until you get harmony with God. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. God brings you in harmony with himself. God brings you in harmony with others. God brings you in harmony with yourself. Anybody ever been in discord with yourself? Come on, somebody. I don't know. Anybody ever been in odds with yourself? I mean, that'll cause some sleepless nights. I don't know about you, but I done had some bad arguments with myself. Come on, somebody. We have to be in harmony with ourselves. Disagreement will stop progress. When you are at odds with yourself, should I do it? Should I not? Should I go? Should I stay? Should I say it? Should I not? Should I give? Should I not? Should I buy it? Should I not? Should I marry? Should I not? Should I have it? Should I not? Or should I keep going? When you're at odds with yourself, it will stagnate your progress. That's why it's important that we be in harmony with God. Because the Bible says that the Holy Spirit will tell you the mind of God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are not a force. You need to be if you are not in harmony with yourself. if you're not in harmony with God. You are not a force you need to be because you're not in agreement with your actions. You're not in agreement with your attitude. You're not in agreement with your heart. Let me show you what the Bible says. Because I want you to clearly understand how disruptive disagreement can be. Let's look at Amos 3:3. Let's look at Amos 3:3. Glory be to God. Amos 3:3. The Bible says, can two walk together unless they are agreed? God, glory to God. Can two walk together unless they agree? The Bible says there's no progress, there's no walk, there's no forward movement without agreement. Watch this. The reason the dwell amongst us God, Emmanuel, became the dwell in us God, Holy Spirit, was so we could have harmony with God. So we could have harmony with God. I don't want to dwell among you. I want to dwell in you. Glory to God. Watch this. Watch this. Luke. Some theologians say he was a doctor, but Luke talks about Jesus being crucified and buried and resurrected. Now, before Jesus was crucified, Jesus showed himself to the world. Before Jesus was crucified, he showed himself to the world. But once he was resurrected, he only exposed himself to believers. When Jesus was resurrected, the resurrected Jesus only exposed himself to believers. Glory be to God. Let me show you why Jesus only exposed himself, the resurrected Jesus only exposed himself to believers. Let's look at Psalms 25:14. Watch this. This is why. The Bible says, the secret of the Lord is with those who fear him, and he will show them his covenant. And he will show them his covenant. Watch this. Watch this. The world and the believer can look at the same thing, but see something different. The world and the believer can look at the same thing, but see something different. Because we are processing our information from a different CPU. We're processing our information from a different CPU. The Bible says Jesus will reveal unto the believer secrets. He will reveal unto the believer how his covenant works. Watch this. To fear means to reverence and to have respect. Those who respect God, he will show you some things he didn't show others. Glory be to God. He will show you some things he didn't show others. Woo. The Bible says that when he was resurrected, Jesus showed himself for 40 days with infallible truth. What's infallible truth? It's truth that cannot be argued against. That means when God knows that you believe in him, when you have faith in God, when you honor God, he'll show you some things that cannot be disputed. He'll show you some things that cannot be crossed out. He'll show you some things that need not be corrected. God will show some things to the believer that the world won't know. For 3.5 years, Jesus was trying to switch us from religion to kingdom. For 3.5 years, Jesus was trying to switch us from religion to kingdom, because religion will keep you in the past. You see, I came from a legalistic religious background, and I went to church scared and I left scared. I went to church unhappy and I left unhappy. You know, until I got hold of kingdom principles, until I got hold of the grace of God, until I got hold of the love of Christ, I then began to go to church happy, and I begin to leave encouraged. I begin to go to church seeking, and I begin to leave church hoping. Glory be to God. Religion, will keep you in the past. But the resurrected Jesus, wanted to dwell in us for relationship. You see, Jesus didn't come for religion. He came for relationship. I need you to understand something today. The kingdom of God is a heart issue. The kingdom of God is a heart issue. That's why Jesus said, back up, Pharisee. Back up, Sadducee. Back up, holy roller. Back up. Because my people only have to love me with all their heart, mind, and soul. My people only have to love their neighbor, and we'll work everything else out. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. The kingdom of God is a heart issue. Whew. Glory to God. The resurrected Jesus wanted to dwell in us for relationship. Because watch this. When you have harmony with God, he'll move you from the present to destiny. You notice how I didn't even mention past? Oh, when the prodigal son came home, he didn't even talk about the past. When I got saved, Jesus didn't ask me nothing about the past. He don't got to ask you about nothing he already know. The blood did it. He said, shut up. I put the blood on that. Listen, relationship, harmony with God will take you from the present to destiny. The present to destiny. Jesus' resurrection says he overcame death and grave. Jesus' resurrection says that he overcame the death and the grave. That's why whatever you go through, you need to understand, my brother, you're not buried, you planted. You see, the world wants us to see our situation as I'm buried. Oh, I'm up under this. I ain't never coming up. Dang it. No, you're not buried, you planted. I don't care what it is. Why? Because when they buried Jesus, he got up, didn't he do it? I said, he got up, didn't he do it? I said, he got up, didn't he do it? Watch this, watch this, watch this. He was giving us a model that through him, we can overcome whatever situation we in. Jesus says there is now. Jesus says there is. Ooh, I felt that right there. There is now resurrecting power in us. There is now resurrecting power in us. Jesus, watch this. Jesus never said we would not be crucified. In fact, I'm crucifying my flesh daily. I don't know about y'all, but I'm working on mine daily. I don't know if they told you, but when I came in here, there was a sign on my back say, Pastor Michael, under construction. Because I'm crucifying my flesh daily. Jesus never said we would not be crucified. In fact, he said we should share in the suffering of his crucifixion. But in 3 days, he got up. I said, in 3 days, he got up. And you will come up. I said, you will come up. Matter of fact, look at somebody and tell them, I got to come up in me. Come on, somebody. I don't know. I got to come up in me. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Glory be to God. Yes, Lord. I got to come up in me. Let's look at 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. 1 John chapter 4. Verse 17. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. I got to come up in me. The Bible says, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Watch this, watch this, watch this, because he is, glory to God, that right there, he is, he is, so we are in the world. See, that right there, he is, so we are in the world. That right there makes you have the confidence that you not buried, you planted. Jesus came up, I'm coming up. Jesus got power, I got power. Jesus was healed, I'm healed. Jesus ain't broke, neither am I. Come on, somebody. He is. He is. So am I. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As he is, I know the world wants to crucify us. I know Satan wants to bury us and shut us up. But Jesus said, we'll come out of it. Jesus says we'll come out of it. God wants you to walk in resurrected power. God wants you to walk in some resurrected power. I've been through some stuff, but I'll come out of it. I had some dark places, but I'll come out of it. My money's funny, but I'll come out of it. I've not been feeling so good in my body, but I'll come out of it. Me and my family been kind of shaky, but I'll come out of it. Because as he is, so are we. Glory to God. Watch this. Watch this, saints. We cannot fight a devil. Watch this. That is coming against us in supernatural ways with natural power. Yeah, tell them. She hear from the Lord. The reason why some of us keep getting our butt kicked in battle is because we keep going to war in our own power. And you got to understand something. Wait, I'm about like 39 or something. Glory to God. Satan got over 4,000 years experience at what he does. We have no business trying to go up against Satan in the natural. The disciples went to Satan in the natural. The Bible says that the demons whooped their butt, stripped them of their clothes, sent them back home naked. We cannot fight a devil that's coming against us in supernatural ways with natural power. We got to walk in the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We got to walk in the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. As he is, so are we. Whew. I'm talking about being in harmony with God. I'm talking about being in harmony with God. Watch this. My best friend back there, his name Brad. I know y'all say, how is he your best friend? We only see him 3 times a year. I don't know. Y'all get him. Glory to God. But I tell you what, Brad, we would be fraudulent. You and I say you and I because I know your business and you know mine. We would be fraudulent to take credit for anything outside the power of God. Amen. If we can't take credit for our car, we can't take credit for our girl, we can't take credit for our glasses, we can't take credit for our tie, we can't take credit for the steak, we can't take credit for the job, we can't take credit for the air, we can't take credit for the anointing. Oh, just, we would be fraudulent to accept credit in our life outside the power of God. That's why I like when the worship team said, I need Jesus. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. I had some dark days. I had some enemy attacks. I've been shot at. I've been wounded. If it had not been for the Lord on my side, I heard Jesus say, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Yes. Glory to God. Has he? Whew, oh, my God. That's a praise break right there. Is there anybody in here to know that God's been better to you than you've been to yourself? Give God some praise. Has he healed you? Praise him. Has he provided for you? Praise him. Come on, you can do better than that. Has he been patient with you? Praise him. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. That's a praise break. Jesus. Whoa. Come on. Come on. Has he been patient with you? Praise him. You know he gave me and you 55,000 chances. You ought to be praising him. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you don't know nothing else when you leave here, you're going to know that preacher's excited and he counting on Jesus. Jesus. That's all we need, Tyra. Glory to God. Now, after 40 days, the resurrected Jesus had to go to glory. Jesus said, unless I go, the Holy Ghost can't come. He says, unless I go, the Holy Ghost can't come. Can you imagine, Nate? Can you imagine Jesus just stayed in our guest room for a week and chopped it up? Obed-Edom said when he took the Ark of the Covenant, oh, my Jewish friends, okay. Obed-Edom said when he took the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the presence of the Lord in his house, the Bible says his dogs was blessed. The Bible says his refrigerator was blessed. It said his garden was blessed. His kids was blessed. His body was blessed. His wife was blessed. His money was blessed. His yard was blessed. His trees was blessed. His refrigerator was blessed. His TV was blessed. His couch was blessed because he had Jesus. Watch this. Watch this. Obed-Edom was so convinced that he needed Jesus when they took the Ark of the Covenant. The Bible says all throughout Scripture, if you pay attention in the Old Testament, wherever the Ark of the Covenant was and they start asking for assignments, Obed-Edom would be in the crowd. Watch this. They said, is there any gatekeepers? Obed-Edom said, I'll do it. Says, I need some ushers. Obed-Edom says, I'll do it. He says, I need some kitchen workers. Obed-Edom said, I'll do it. He says, how you doing? I need some greeters. Obed-Edom said, I'll do it. Come on, somebody, because he wanted to be in the presence of the Lord. Woo! Glory to God. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So here's the disciples. And Jesus is telling them, after chopping it up with them for 3.5 years, I gotta go. Ooh. He said, I gotta go now, y'all. But the disciples had to have enough faith to let go to receive their blessing. I got a word for somebody in here today. Until you let go, God can't release your blessing. Ooh. I don't know who I'm preaching to today, but God says you're going to have enough faith to let go that I can release your blessing. You see, the disciples had to have enough faith to let Jesus go to receive the blessing. Man of God, the Bible says as Jesus was ascending, he was blessing them. The problem we got is most of us are operating on sacrifice and not obedience. We need the obedience of faith, not the sacrifice of faith. I give you something this week. I don't know about next week. I'll serve when I get time. I'll pray when I ain't sleepy. I'll tell a testimony if I feel like it. I'll read the Bible if my favorite show ain't on. God's not releasing a blessing in this season on sacrifice. He's releasing it on obedience. You see, the disciples were obedient. They didn't say, well, Jesus, we'll let you go today and we need you back tomorrow. They said, go ahead, Jesus. Send the Holy Ghost. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus says, if I remain with you, I cannot dwell in you. If I remain with you, I cannot dwell in you. I got a question for y'all today. Is your faith with you or is it in you? Oh, okay. Wait a minute. That was too holy. Is Jesus on the outside of you or is Jesus on the inside of you? Oh, okay. Well, then watch this then. Is Satan on the outside of you or is he on the inside of you? Oh, y'all don't want to hear that, huh? Okay, let me come on down here. Watch this. If Jesus, man of God, lives on the inside of you, you can never be possessed. Because Jesus and Satan can't operate in the same house. But you can be oppressed. Satan can push on you. And the reason why every time Satan pushes us and we gotta fall down and get back up, because we ain't got enough word in us. Because when you start eating the word on a regular basis, you become strong enough, because Satan's still going to push you. But this time when he pushes on you, you ain't falling down. You just lean a little bit like Faith Weeble. You wobble, but you don't fall down. Good punch, Satan. Good punch, Satan. But I ain't going down. Good punch, Satan. But I ain't going down. Ooh, you hit me with a good one last month. But I ain't going down. Why? Because I got enough strength in me to stand firm. Because I'm not operating on sacrifice. I'm operating on obedience. Somebody say amen. Yeah. Woo! Glory to God. Hallelujah. This Holy Ghost preaching. Is Jesus hanging around you or is Jesus in you? Is Jesus hanging around you or is Jesus in you? Jesus told the disciples, watch this. A Bible reader's that. You guys ever wonder how, watch this. E-church, internet church, Facebook, how you doing? I got a question for you. You ever wonder how is it that Jesus told the disciples to go out and preach the gospel in all of the world, but none of them was preachers? They was tax collectors. They was fishermen, they was pimps, they was thieves, they was crooks, but none of them was preachers. And Jesus said, go out and preach to the world. See, what you got to understand is when you read the Bible, you got to read it like this. He's talking to them, but speaking to me. It is a manual. It is an example. It is a prelude. It is principles for victorious living. Watch this. Jesus told the disciples, go out and preach the gospel. And they weren't preachers because Jesus wanted them in their assignment to lean on him. When God gives you an assignment, he gives you an assignment that you need him to succeed. Let me tell you something. If you can do what it is you think you're doing in your own strength, in your own plan, in your own might, in your own spirit, that's not God. That may be a good thing, but it's not a God thing. Because my Bible says, not by my might, not by my spirit, but by his holy power. You need to understand, when God gives you an assignment, you're going to need his power to accomplish it. But the good news is, God will never give you an assignment without the power and the resources to accomplish it. Amen. God will never give you an assignment without the power and the resources to accomplish it. God sent me to Prescott. I didn't know one person. I said, God, this is a bad joke or a great trick. I don't know which. But look what he's doing. Because all I did was be obedient and said, yes, Lord. And then I began to say no to some other stuff. When you say yes to God, there's some stuff you're going to have to say no to. Oh, y'all wasn't that bad, huh? Okay. Let me come over here and talk to these people. Y'all real holy over there. When you say yes to God, it's some stuff you got to say no to. Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. I'm preaching better than they talking. Trish, what's wrong with them? Glory to God. Hallelujah. When God gives you an assignment, you will need his power to accomplish it. Watch what the Bible says. Because he sent the disciples out, and he said, go preach the gospel. But they weren't preachers. But look what he said about it, Kaylee. Let's look at Acts 1:8. Look what he said. He says, but you shall receive power. Watch this. When the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Watch this. Watch this. How you know he's talking about their preacher? Because he said, you shall be witnesses to me. What's that? He said, now when you go preach, I'm sending you out with power. How many of you understand that when we receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, it's more than speaking in tongues? Amen. I'm tired of people beating my people up with religion, telling them, if you don't speak in tongues, you ain't saved. If you don't speak in tongues, you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost. Well, that's not true. I may have a prayer language that I use just at home. Plus, you got to understand something. There are other gifts to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, like a vacuum cleaner. You ever had a vacuum cleaner in your house and it broke? You notice how when your vacuum cleaner breaks and you get ready to throw it away and you turn it around and all the little parts on the back is brand new. Because all you've been doing is using this part. You never use the other tools. The Bible says that if I'm baptized in the Holy Ghost, that is the power to demonstrate the gospel. So I got some other aspects to being baptized in the Holy Ghost. Now don't get me wrong, your prayer language is powerful and needed. But there are some other avenues. There's some other gifts of being baptized in the Holy Ghost. Whew. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. If God is going to use us in this last revival, if God is going to be able to use us in these troubling times, if God is going to be able to use the church in this confused world, then we're going to need the power of the Holy Ghost. Then we're going to need the power of the Holy Ghost. Watch this. Let me show you something. Let's go to Acts 2. Take me to Acts 2, please, James. Watch this. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord, in one place. Watch this. Watch this. Suddenly, there came a sound from heaven, as rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house, and they were sitting. Then appeared them divided tongues. Now, watch this. When he says divided tongues, he's not speaking of division. He's saying everybody had their own prayer language. Everybody had their own gift. Me speaking in tongues is not predicated on you. My prayer language is not predicated on you. Everybody had their own relationship with God. Glory to God. Watch this. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Watch this. Watch this. And begin to speak with other tongues. If we're going to operate in the power of heaven, I'm going to show you some things through this scripture, through Bible. Because remember I told you, and showed you in Bible that when you really reverence God, he will unveil some things to you that the world can't see. Well, sometimes when a preacher really presses in, God will allow him behind the word to extrapolate kingdom principles to share with his congregation that they could walk in victory. You see, Robert, when I had to stay home Friday night and you went out for pizza. You see, on Saturday when I had to go to bed at 7 and you stayed up for a movie. You see, when y'all got a chance to go on vacation, I had to stay pressing in. It was so that I could get closer to God and that he could reveal things to me that I could bring to you and we could walk in victory. You see, when I get to heaven, my reward is what I bring to you through him. Glory be to God. So I'm willing to be obedient so that I could bring kingdom principles to you that you could live in victory. I just heard God say to calm down so y'all can get it all. Okay. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Watch this. If we want to operate in the power of heaven, we must position ourselves. Okay. So through the scripture we just read, I'm going to let you behind it and show you how it is we position ourselves. Number one, principle number one, principle number one. You ready? You ready, Shiloh? Principle number one, we got to get rid of our Judas. We got to get rid of our Judas. Before the disciples could go to the upper room, Zach, they had to get rid of Judas and bring on Matthias. They had to kill Judas. They had to get rid of Judas. Principle number one, we got to get rid of Judas. Why is that? You see, Judas had a separate agenda. He had another purpose. You see, Judas represented disruption of unity, of purpose. Judas represented a disruption of unity, of purpose, because Judas had a different purpose than the 11. Let me show you. Let me teach. Judas' purpose was to expose the gospel. The other 11's purpose was to preach the gospel. Watch this. Judas was the one who kissed Jesus on the forehead to expose Jesus to the enemy. They didn't know who Jesus was until Judas wouldn't kiss him. So Judas's purpose was to expose the gospel. But the 11 disciples' purpose was to preach the gospel. So Judas was disrupting the unity of the purpose. So number one, we got to get rid of Judas. We got to get rid of the Judas in our life. You got to kill your Judas in order to have unity of purpose. Okay. Your Judas may be anger. Your Judas may be lust. Okay, wait a minute. I'm going to be on your street in a minute. Hold on, y'all. Hold on. Your Judas may be self-righteousness. Your Judas may be bigotry. Yeah. Your Judas may be drugs. Your Judas may be stubbornness. Your Judas may be doubt. But if we're going to be united, we got to kill our Judas. We cannot have a Pentecostal experience unless we come into agreement. We cannot have a Pentecostal experience unless we come into agreement. Oh, okay. Watch this. Let me show you Matthew 18, 19. Look at Matthew 18, 19. It says, I say to you, if any two touch and agree on earth concerning anything that you ask, I'll do it. By my Father in heaven. Do you see the power of agreement? Jesus says agreement is so powerful that I'll release some stuff from heaven. Glory to God. So that brings me to principle number two. Number two, we must be on one accord. We must be on one accord. Watch this. The Bible says that in the upper room, they were in one accord. One accord is about harmony. One accord is about harmony. We can't have a Pentecostal experience in disagreement. Watch this. Let me give you a musical example of a chord. Help me out with this, Frank. Watch this. A chord allows you to sing in harmony with your own range. Am I right about it? A chord allows you to sing in harmony with your own range. You see, watch this, watch this. When we can appreciate each other's range, we don't have to force somebody else to be just like us. When we can appreciate somebody else's range, we don't have to force them to be just like us. Watch this. Harmony means I can be different as long as I fit. Harmony means I can be different as long as I fit. Watch this. You see, in a harmony, you can hit a C note, an E note, and a G note, and that's a chord. Now, there are different notes that harmonize to produce one sound. Amen. Oh. We can be different without violating unity. One accord. Principle number two, we got to be on one accord. Watch this. Satan is a divider. God is a multiplier. Okay. Raise your hand if you got kids. Didn't he do it? Didn't he do it? God has designed us to multiply when we touch and agree. God has designed us to multiply when we touch and agree. Glory be to God. Woo! If we want a sound from heaven, we must be in harmony with God. If we want a sound from heaven, we must be in harmony with others. If we want a sound from heaven, we must be in harmony with ourselves. Remember, I'm talking about how can we operate in the power of the Holy Ghost in these troubling times. Principle number three. Principle number three. We must be able, glory to God, to hear. We must be able to hear. We must be able to hear the Holy Spirit. We must be able to hear others. In order to hear, we must turn off the emotions of the world. One of the problems we have in today right now is we can't hear one another. Oh my gosh. Watch this. Watch this. Oh my gosh. This is going to bless your socks off. Your mouth creates a problem when your ears can't hear. Where my husband's at? When your wife start talking, Brian, if we ain't really hearing, we'll say some things that'll create a greater problem. You ever heard your wife say something and you just listen, You just give it a Because you heard God say, don't fight that one. So you just have to look at him and say, Oh my gosh. Listen. Your mouth will get you in trouble when your ears can't hear. Oh my gosh. Watch this. You ever notice that when a deaf person, and I'm not speaking bad about deaf people, don't tweet me. We just talking. We just chopping it up. But a deaf person, and before I even say this about the deaf person, let's just say this. When you lose one thing, God strengthens another. So don't be so quick to talk crazy about the deaf people. I'm just using this as an example. A deaf person, ma'am, talk funny. Why is that? Because they can't hear. When you can't hear, you talk crazy. Number three, we gotta be able to hear. Okay, let me show you Bible. Because if it ain't Bible, if it ain't Bible, let's look at Revelations 2:7. Glory be to God. I said principle number three, you gotta be able to hear. Watch this. Look at the Bible. Look at the Bible. Oh my gosh, I just love the Bible. Job said he esteems the word of God greater than food. Look at the Bible. It says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to Mount Zion Tabernacle Church. He didn't say him who have a mouth, let him speak. He says him who have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Whew. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Preacher, how do you know that principle number three is hearing? How do you know that, preacher? The Bible says when they were in the upper room, they were sitting. Sitting is a position for listening. The reason why he magnified that they were sitting in the upper room because they were listening for the Holy Spirit. Number three, listening for the Holy Spirit. Are you listening, church? If we're going to have a Pentecostal experience, we got to get rid of Judas. If we're going to have a Pentecostal experience, we got to get on one accord. If we're going to have a Pentecostal experience, we got to listen to the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that when they were in the upper room, they got rid of Judas. The Bible says when they were in the upper room, oh my gosh, they got on one accord. The Bible says when they were in the upper room, they got rid of disagreement. The Bible says when they were in the upper room, they start to listen. The Bible says that when they were in the upper room, suddenly a sound came. Oh, I hear God saying that if I will send a sound from heaven, if I could get the right sound from earth. Oh, God said that when they were in the upper room, suddenly a sound came. I hear God saying, I'm getting ready to turn it around. Somebody's healing. God says, today I'm getting ready to turn around somebody's marriage. Today, I hear God saying, I'm getting ready to turn around somebody's finances. Today, I hear God saying, I'm getting ready to turn around somebody's children. Today, I hear God saying, I'm getting ready to turn around somebody's career. Today, I hear God say, I'm getting ready to turn around somebody's ministry. And I hear God say, I'm getting ready to turn it around. Suddenly, oh my gosh, suddenly, if we will get on one accord, God says, I'll open up the window and pour out a blessing. He says, suddenly, is there anybody in here wanting a suddenly blessing today? God says, if I can hear the right sound on earth, I'll send a sound from heaven. My Bible says, on earth as it is in heaven. Oh my gosh, watch this, watch this. On the count of three, I want us to make a sound. Because I feel a suddenly in this room today. Glory be to God. Whenever you bring a correct, accurate, poignant word of God, and there's a response, God always responds. That's why God says the answer to his promise is yes and amen. Because he intended for you to make a response. Every promise God has, there's something tied to it that you and I must do. Even our salvation, we had to give up our faith. Come on, somebody. Amen. Listen to me. Listen to me. Today, God's getting ready to release a suddenly in this place. I don't know what you need. But today, I hear God saying, if I can hear a sound from earth, I'll send a mighty sound from heaven, a suddenly blessing. I'm going to count to three, and I want us to send a sound up to heaven that we receive a suddenly blessing in this place. I don't pastor a passive church. I pastor a Holy Ghost church in Jesus' name, a Holy Ghost church. In Jesus' name, on the count of three, I want every blood washed, baptized, Jesus filled, devil stomping, hitting devil in the mouth, tongue talking Christian to make a sound in this place. One, two, three, yeah. That's enough. Yeah. 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 That's a sound. That's a sound. Yeah. That's a sound. Woo. That's a sound. Hallelujah. 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 Get him going. Woo. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Glory to God. Come on up, ushers. Woo! Hallelujah. 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 Glory to God. Woo! Preacher, I need you right there. I need you right here. Eric, I need you to bring a girl with you, a lady with you. Woman of God, get her. I need you right here. Please. Hallelujah. Pam, I need you in this altar right here. Here at Mount Zion Tabernacle Church, we don't beg. Let me tell you something. And I'm just saying this as humble as I know how, right? Because if I don't testify, well, nobody else. And not only, I am a testimony. You are too. Watch this. Watch this. We're operating on obedience. God told me to leave my job. I struggled with that. You know I did, Tyra. People in the congregation were telling me, when you gonna leave? I got people now telling me to stop my landscaping business. I left my job and I was making $31 an hour. Imagine what I made on overtime days. $31 an hour, the greatest insurance in the world. My boss was my friend. And God said, I need you to leave and be full-time ministry. You know how when God tell you them tough things, he got to really kick you out? He literally had to put me out. I began to walk in obedience. We didn't even have insurance for a year and a half. No life insurance. No health insurance. A year and a half. Every time my wife got sick, I would just say, Lord, you the insurance. Every time she said her back hurt, I'll say, Lord, you the insurance. But I moved in obedience. Because God doesn't bless sacrifice, but he'll bless your socks off for obedience. I almost took my socks off right there. Glory to God. Listen to me. If I have to beg at Mount Zion, I'll go back to my job. You see, here in Mount Zion, giving is a heart issue. It's a heart issue. God doesn't care what's in your hand. He wants to know what's in your heart. He wants to know, will you be obedient with what I told you to do? And he'll bless your socks off. If he tells you buy that man of God a suit every year, you do it. And you probably will never run out of suits the rest of your life. Let me tell you one more story. True story. So me and my best friend was in this store one time. And we didn't realize that the store was going out of business. The store was going out of business. And so I'm in the store. And I'm picking up these Michael Jordan, Air Nikes, and these tennis shoes, Lee, that I know is $150. And I looked at the price, and it said $20. I said, this must be a mistake. So I went to the other shoes, and they said $5. Some said $10. I said, the people must be drunk in here. We better hurry up and get these before they find out what they did. So I called my best friend up on the phone. I said, you better get down here right now. These shoes is $5, $10, and $20. Now I'm telling you a real story. I'm the preacher. My friend rushed in there in about 10 minutes. He started piling shoes up on the counter. He had about 20 shoes piled up on the counter. I had about 15. So I looked at his shoes and I said, all them your size? He said, yeah, I'm in a hurry because I'm getting ready to go to the casino. I said, you at the casino right now. You don't even know it. He said, what you talking about, man? I said, put them shoes back in your size. Go get every other shoe size that we can give away. He said, looked at me, said, you serious? I said, I'm serious. He said, bet. We went and got every shoe that wasn't our size. And then we got 40 shoes apiece. Put them up there, bam, size 2, size 6, size 7, size 8, and stacked them up there. And the man said, y'all getting all these? We said, we want them all. And I looked at my friend, and I said, ching, ching, you in the casino. Ching, ching, you in the casino. And I guarantee you, you will never see me and him without a pair of shoes. Because we sold into the kingdom. We didn't get it twisted. Some of us are getting it twisted. You get a seed and you think it's food. If you stop eating your seed and start sowing it, your harvest will be bountiful. I'm not saying clear your bank account, do whatever, give all your money. Now, if God tell you to, that's between you and God. I'm saying make sure you know what's seed and what's food. When it's time to give, you should simply say, God, what are you doing in this house and what do you need me to do? God, what are you doing in this house? My internet church, e-church, we got three ways to give, but don't you give a dime till you ask this question. God, what are you doing and what do you need me to do? Watch this. When you ask God that question, guess what he does? He plays reciprocity with you. And then he comes back to you and says, okay, Martin, since you asked me that question and you did what I said, now let me ask you a question. Martin, what do you need and what are you doing? That's what he asked Solomon. God, what are you doing in that house? And what do you need us to do? He'll bless your socks off. He'll bless your socks off. He'll bless your socks off. Ooh, felt that thing. He'll bless your socks off. Giving is not about sacrifice. It's about obedience. God doesn't care what's in your hand. He wants to know what's in your heart. It's time to give, Mount Zion. Did you hear him, man? I didn't hear him. Did you hear him? It's time to give, Mount Zion.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Is you all I need?
getting ready to open this altar up, and there is a suddenly in this altar today. I don't know what you need. It's between you and God. But I'm telling you right now, if you'll be bold enough to come to this altar, find one of these people. Because the minute I asked them to get to this altar, there was an anointing on them. Simply because they're doing what God has told me to tell them what to do. Transferable. Anointing is transferable. That's how Elijah got it. Am I right about it, man of God? Today, ma'am, there is a suddenly in this altar. A suddenly, sir, in this altar. I don't know what it is that you need, but don't mess around today. When I open up this altar, I want you to come running to one of these people and ask them to stand in agreement for your suddenly, because today's the day. E-Church, get up. Grab hands with somebody in the house. Touch and agree. I'm transferring a suddenly anointing through the airwaves. There's an anointing on me today. I declare suddenly in this altar. I don't know if it's healing that you need. I don't know if it's deliverance that you need. I don't know if it's wisdom that you need. I don't know if it's peace that you need. I don't know if it's increase that you need. I don't know if it's a break from a drug addiction. I don't know if it's depression or loneliness. But today, today, it's a suddenly in this altar. But I'm going to stand right here. And if there's anybody that does not know Jesus, you come to me. Now, I can't get you saved, but I'm going to lead you through the throne of grace. Because I don't care how good you preach. And we preach the paint off the walls up in here, up in here, up in here. But that's nothing if you don't give them an opportunity to know Jesus. You didn't do nothing. So I'm going to be right here. If you need Jesus, if he's convicting your heart, you just come to me. But if you need a suddenly today, get to this altar. The doors of the church is open. Come on. Get up. If you need a suddenly, come to the altar right now. Right now. Come. Come. Yes. 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 There is a suddenly in this altar right now. Luke, I need you up here. Come now. Come now. Come now. Woman of God, come now, come now. There's a suddenly in this altar. That's right. Come now, come now, come now, come now. There's a suddenly in this altar today. Come now, come now, come now, come now. Come here, preacher. Stand right there. Help them pray. There's a suddenly in this altar right now. I release a suddenly now in Jesus' name in this altar. Glory to God. I need everybody sitting in the pews to stretch your hands to the altar and pray for a suddenly. Pray for a suddenly. Pray for a suddenly right now. Pray for a suddenly right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. Right now. A suddenly breakthrough right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Pray for a suddenly right now. Right now. There's a suddenly healing in this altar right now.
Oh,
Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Glory to God. Stand to your feet. Hallelujah. 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 We pray right now in Jesus' precious name, Lord God, that you would hide your word in the heart of these, oh God. Lord, hide your kingdom principles in their heart. Lord, we ask that you would begin to use these principles to position us. Lord, that you could move through the power of the Holy Ghost and use us in this last revival. Lord, use us to help in this dark world, in this troubled time. Lord, use us to help in these confused times, Lord. The people are confused. People are hurting. Lord, we are your church, and we are ready and willing to do your assignment. Oh, God, send a sound from heaven. Send Holy Ghost dunamis power, Lord, for we can't do this without you. Lord God, I'm asking that you put a special hedge of protection around their hearts. Put a hedge of protection around their minds, because I know the enemy is going to try to steal this word. Oh God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Glory to God. I'll see you next Sunday. Woo.